Hey, Impact. Good to be with you guys. If I haven't met you yet, my name is Brad. I'm one of the youth pastors around here, and I just want to thank you for being here. I love watching you guys. I always love to just see you guys worship the Lord and just be together. If you're new to Impact, there's always people here every week that are new. I just want to tell you I'm so proud of you for being here. I'm so thankful that you chose to come and be with us in this space. And I know we've talked about a variety of things tonight, some of them heavy. We've worshiped the Lord together, but we want you to know wherever you are that we believe this is a place where God is going to move. And we believe our God is on the move, that he's alive, that he wants to do something in our lives, that he is so real, and that he actually wants to connect with us deep in our inner being, and he has something for you. And I believe that tonight. So we're going to open the Bible. We're going to dive into the scriptures a little bit, and we're going to finish this series called I Am Second. We have had, a good journey together as a youth group to start the school year, and I think God's got some good things for us tonight. I want to ask you a question. Have you ever liked something so much that you could not get enough of it? Has this ever happened to you? Have you ever had something like this in your life that you liked so much that you could not get enough of it? Like it was, it was that thing and you loved it. Have you ever had a food in your life that was so good you could eat that food until you were sick? Like, do you have foods like this? Shout them out. What are those foods? Chipotle. Pumpkin spice lattes. Okay, we got a few of them out there. We got a few items like that. Let me ask you this one. All right, let me bring you back. Have you ever, now you got to be a little vulnerable here. You got to open up your heart a little bit. Have you ever had something in your life that you liked so much, it was actually a bad thing? Like if you're honest, it was not a good thing in your life because you liked it so much. I'm going to be real transparent with you here for a second, okay? I got to that level with this little video game out there called Fortnite. Now, I was never any good at Fortnite. I was not a good player, but I had the great privilege of having some friends that were really good, and several of them are in this room, actually. There was a group of guys that came to the youth group years ago. And guys named Ben and Blake and Keegan, and they had a buddy named Dave, and they had their squad of four, and they would just terminate people in Fortnite. Like, they were so, so good. And actually, Ben is here. He's one of your small group leaders. Ben, where are you? Where's Ben Schwartz? Here. Ben is back here. There's Ben. So Ben is, I'm not kidding you, Ben, at least he was exceptionally good at Fortnite. Like, he was very good. He was a very good player. And I'm going to give some credit to Nick Adams over here. He's pretty good at Fortnite, too, but didn't play with him. Anyway, occasionally these four guys would have an opening on their squad. Like, one of them wouldn't be there. And they would maybe occasionally text me. I'm like, I'm not even the B team. I'm like the C team, okay, like struggling. But they would text me and be like 10 o'clock at night. My kids are in bed. I get on to play Fortnite, and it's so much fun, especially when we're playing with good people. And they had a rule, and the rule was if you won, you couldn't be done. You can't end on a dub. Does anybody else have this rule? Was this just us, Ben? Are we the only people that had this rule, you can't end on a dub? Guys, I would play this game, and I'm like an old man up here, okay? I'd play this game sometimes till 2, 3 a.m. on a work night. I'm like, what am I doing? That was so dumb. I would feel terrible the next day because I'd have to get up and get my kids off to school. And it just wrecked me every time. And I'd always think, why did I do that? But I just got roped in. You know what I'm saying? You just get roped into some things. But I tell you what, this series that we're in called I Am Second, we've got a specific purpose, like a goal in this series. I think it actually comes out of something that Jesus said in Matthew chapter 22. And Matthew 22, it's not going to be on the screen, but, it is. Wow, I do have it on the screen. I don't even know what slides I got tonight. All right, it's on the screen. Matthew 22, some really smart people who knew the Bible super well, they came up to Jesus and they said, hey, what is the greatest commandment in the Bible? And that's actually an interesting question if you think about it, because it's essentially saying, out of all the things that God wants you to do, what's the number one thing? Out of everything that God wants for you and from you and of you, what's the biggest thing that God wants for you? And I think Jesus' answer is actually amazing. I mean, you can see it there on the screen. screen. Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus replied, this is Matthew 22, 34, 36, actually 36. And in verse 37, he just says, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And I want you to hear this. Actually, some of you really need to hear this because you've got a messed up view of God. I know you do. I've met enough of you. There's somebody here, your view of God is distorted in some really rough ways. And I want you to hear me tonight. Out of all the things God wants of you, all the things that he thinks of for you, do you know what the number one thing he wants? He just says, love me. Like, that's what I want. That's what God has always wanted. Like, sometimes we get this messed up view that God wants our behavior, that God wants a checklist. I've got to check boxes off a list. And I'm just trying to tell you, that is not God. God is, his heart in the deepest parts of who he is, as far as I can tell, he's just wanting you to love him. And he does add something to that, though. Do you see it? He says that he wants you to love him how? With all of you, with everything in you, all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. And then which commandment is this? This is the first and greatest commandment. And if this is first, that means there are other things that have to be second. And we've been on a journey together as a youth group, and we've been just trying to come to a place where we can see God create in us a deeper desire, maybe even a deeper understanding as to why we would put him first in our lives. And to end this series, I think we have to have some important conversations together. I think there are some challenges to putting God first that we have got to deal with as a youth group. I'm going to ask you some questions that I don't want you to answer. Some of them maybe will connect with you, others may not. They are going to come up on the screen. But I really want to ask you, I think they're questions that God wants us to ask. Here's the first one. Who or what do you want more than anything? Second one. Who or what do you live for? Last one, who or what can you not live without? And I want you to be honest with yourself tonight. And I'm with you. We all, at times, answer those questions with something other than God. Everybody does. The strongest Christian that you know, at times in their life, their answer to that question or any of those questions or one of those questions at times, don't we? We all answer those questions with something other than God at certain moments in our lives. There have been so many moments in my recent, life where if I were to really be honest about who or what, that I want more than anything else, what is it that consumes my thoughts and my energy in my deepest desires, the most central place in my heart, there are times when it's not God. And the thing that I'd like to do tonight is I'd like to ask a follow-up question. If you're willing to admit that sometimes that's true of you, I think maybe then the real question needs to be, when something other than God is first, what do we find? When something other than God is first, what is actually at the end of that path? And we got a little ahead, but you can see the first one that I want to give you. When something other than God is first, I believe always we find that whatever that is, it leaves us empty. Have you felt emptiness in your life before? You know what that's like yet? I bet you do in some ways. Emptiness is something that comes into, I think, our hearts when we look at the things in our lives and we see how little they amount to. We see how little good that they actually bring. There's a book of the Bible that you probably have not read, and that's okay. It's not the one I would tell you to go read, honestly, right off the bat. If you're getting into the Bible, if you're trying to read the Bible, it would not be the first book I'd recommend you read. It's the book of Ecclesiastes. There's a certain few books in the Bible that are total downers, like total downers. The book of Jeremiah is actually a downer. Like, it's hard. It's a hard read. It's a long read. It's a hard read. God is in a bad place with his people, and he's saying that. But Ecclesiastes is a hard read as well. It's got some very good parts, but let me put the first verse of Ecclesiastes up here. Check this out. This is literally, not the first, this is the second verse. Ecclesiastes 1:2. Maybe you can see why I say that it's a downer. You see it?
What's the first word? What's the second word? Yeah, meaningless, meaningless, utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. That's how Ecclesiastes starts. Now, let me walk you through the book just for a second. I'm going to give you the headings of the next several sections of the book. You ready? The first heading is everything is meaningless. The second one is wisdom is meaningless. Then it says pleasures, meaningless, advancement, meaningless, riches, meaningless. It's interesting because Ecclesiastes was written by one of the most prosperous and successful guys that's ever lived, a guy named Solomon, known as one of the wisest people ever to walk the earth, one of the richest, most fantastically wealthy people that's ever lived. And this guy writes this book, who is a king of the nation of Israel, God's people, and he tells God's people, meaningless, meaningless. Everything is meaningless, utterly meaningless. And how does he end the book of Ecclesiastes? He actually gives you the whole point of the book at the end. Here's the last verse, one of the last verses of Ecclesiastes. This is chapter 12, verse 13. Now all has been heard. Here's the conclusion of the matter. Fear God, keep his commandments. That is the whole duty of man. And again, we've got to translate that. We've got to understand that. I don't want you to get a messed up view of God, but what he's saying is when he says fear God, he's meaning stand in awe of the amazingness of who God is. And when he says obey his commands, he's actually talking to the people of God who were in a relationship with God where he asked them to be different. And that relationship with him is dependent on them living differently. And that's why he says obey his commands, not because that's all God wants, but because the end duty of us is to have God. And every other thing in this world, if it is before him, if it is in front of him, if it is more than him, it ends up leaving you and me empty. It does. That's where it takes us. I want to tell you an interesting case study here. A person, I'm going to talk about a person you probably don't know. His name's Boris Becker. Anybody know who that is? You shouldn't, because he was famous a long time ago. But Boris Becker was an unbelievable tennis player. I think back in the 80s, maybe, unbelievable tennis player. He still, to this day, is the youngest player to win Wimbledon, which is like one of the top tennis tournaments in the world. He won that tournament, won it, as a 17-year-old. I'll put his picture on the screen. This is a picture of Boris Becker as a 17-year-old, and then this other picture is him as a 26-year-old when he won his sixth Grand Slam title in Australia. And the guy was amazing, an amazing tennis player, phenomenal, unbelievable, like one of the probably one of the best ever. And I'm going to read to you a quote from Boris Becker. This is what he said. I had won Wimbledon twice before, once as the youngest player. I was rich. I had all the material possessions I needed. It's the old song of movie stars and pop stars who commit suicide. They have everything, and yet they are so unhappy. I had no inner peace. I was a puppet on a string. In April of this year, Boris Becker was sentenced to 2 years in prison, and he's currently in jail right now, that guy. He was sentenced to 2 years in prison for something illegal he did with money. I can't even tell you. All I'm asking you to think about today is maybe to consider the truth of the matter, that when something other than God is first, that's where it takes you. That's where it takes me. It, number one, it will leave us empty. And number two, and this is the last thought I want to give you, it will never be enough. Whatever it is that becomes in, you know, something that's in front of God, that jumps ahead of God in our lives, whatever that is, it will never be enough. I think the trademark thing, the trademark reality of the things of the world is that they always leave us thirsting for more. Jesus has this moment in John chapter 4 where he meets a woman who's from a different kind of people in that area named from Samaria. They were Samaritans. And he meets her and he asks her for a drink of water from this well that she's at. It's a kind of an odd story, but it's really interesting. And she looks at him and she thinks it's odd that he's talking to him. And she's like, why are you asking me for a drink? And then he says this to her. I want to read this for you. This is John 4, 13 through 14. Jesus answers this woman. He says, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. And I believe Jesus is just trying to get a simple truth to us. Like if all you do in your life is try to drink from the things of this world, from the well of this world, I want you to know what you'll find. You will find that you will always be thirsty again, always. And your Savior, the God of the universe who made you, who knows the inner workings of your heart and your mind and your soul, he wants to, I believe, come up next to you and say, I have something for you that nothing in this world can give you. And if you'll make me first, everything else is going to work better. Everything else is going to fit where it should. Throughout this series, we've been listening to some stories of people who are just processing this journey with you, people who have had their own imperfections. We've heard a couple of great stories as a youth group. I want to end with a testimony from a guy named Pete Briscoe. I want you to hear Pete's story. Check it out.
I think the emptiness happens when you get to the place that you thought would make you happy and you discover it doesn't. Or the emptiness happens when you continually strive to get to that place and don't quite reach it. It's two different kinds of emptiness, but it's emptiness nevertheless. When I was a little guy and people asked me, what do you want to be when you grow up? At first, it was a fireman, and then it was a policeman. But then around 10 or 12, my answer became very different. Every time someone asked me, what do you want to be when you grow up? I said the same thing. I said, I want to be the best. And they would look at me and say, the best at what? And I would say, I don't care. It doesn't matter. I just want to be the best at something. I think it came from the fact that I liked attention. And I noticed that the kids who were really good at things got more attention than the kids who were less so. And so at the core of who I was, it was really about people thinking highly of me and just feeding off that attention. There was one basketball game when I scored 52 points and I was the best player on the court that night. And I remember going back in the locker room and people patting me on the back and getting changed and going out, and everything was still the same as it was before I scored 52 points. And I thought, dang, it isn't as good as I thought it would be. It didn't meet the need that I felt I had. And so I needed to find something that was, or someone that was. Christ is first in my life because he is magnificently first in everything. And it's simply my recognition of who he is. He is first because he's better than me at everything. Anything I can try to do, he can do it better. He's first because he passionately loves me. There's nothing I can do to make him love me more. There's nothing I can do to make him love me less. He loves me perfectly right now. So he is first in my life because he's passionately crazy about me, whether I'm doing well or not, whether I'm performing beautifully or not, whether I just sinned miserably or not. He's nuts about me. He's crazy about me. How can someone like that not be first? When they make you first, he made me first in his life. He went to the cross for me. He thoroughly sacrificed himself for me. He made me first. And when I come to grips with that depth of love, with his passion for me, it seems incongruent to allow anything else to be first. He's got to be first. I'm Pete Briscoe, and I am second.
So, I mean, I want you to just process with me as we end tonight, as we get ready to go into our small groups. I know that all of you are at different places with this. There are some of you that I have watched you live with such a heart to put Jesus first, and you're striving for that. There are others of you that are a whole other place, and you're not even sure where you're at with God or what you think about Jesus.
But I believe that we all experience the same thing. And if we'll at least ask tonight, you know, what is it that you're at least tempted to want more than anything? What is it in your life that you feel like, or at least you're tempted to believe, that you can't live without that? What are those things that are not God? And you know in your heart, you're drawn to them in a way that probably isn't good for you. In a way that actually takes you somewhere that you don't even want to go. And I think if for a moment you'll recognize what those are for you, if maybe you'll even fill in this blank, I'm going to put up on the screen, it just says blank will never satisfy me. Like, are you willing, you don't have to say it out loud, but are you willing to kind of say that in your heart right now? Again, whatever you'd put in that blank is your thing. And for some of you, you'll put something in that blank and you'll go, you know what, it's not a huge struggle, but I know that sometimes that tends to jump ahead of God in my life. And I need to fill in that blank and I need to say that name, or I need to say that thing, and I need to say it will never satisfy me, and I need to be reminded of that tonight. There are others of you in this room. Here's how I'd want you to fill in the blank. A life without Jesus will never satisfy me. A life far from him will never satisfy me. You can be the youngest player to win your thing. You can have all the material possessions in the world. And if you don't have Jesus Christ, will it ever be enough? And here's what's so crazy about the message of Jesus, the real message of Jesus. It says in Philippians chapter 2, verse 6, that Jesus emptied himself by dying on a cross. In that moment, as he gave his life on the cross, he took on your emptiness. He came to this earth to empty himself so that every single moment where you and I try to fill our lives with something other than Jesus, all of those moments where we ran to something else and we loved something else and all our heart, soul, mind, and strength was far from him, he saw it and he took on all the emptiness that it brings on himself so that he could fill you, so that he could fill me, so that he could give us a life that is full and meaningful and real and packed with joy and peace and strength and wisdom. That's the life he offers you. And he asks you, will you draw near to me? Will you run to me? Will you make me the thing that you place above all others? And if you'll do that, you'll never be the same. He'll change you. He'll help you. He'll be with you. And you'll find something that nothing in this world will ever give you. So Father in heaven, I pray for these students that they would experience right now a sense in their heart of what it is that you're wanting to talk to them about, what it is that you're inviting them to put second, as we talked about a couple weeks ago, what it is tonight that they need to recognize will never satisfy them. And God, would you help each one in this room to have the courage to call it out, to have the desire to see you come in and be first. And would you renew in us or create in us a desire to make you our number one, to love you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Lord, would you bless these students as they do that? And would you take such good care of them as they run after you? It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.